Once the opportunity arose for him to close the show, he did it in emphatic style.
Whatever he hits falls.
Andrew McCart, IFL TV, in association with MTK Global.
I'm here in New York. With me, I've got Eddie Hearn. Eddie, you've been kind enough to invite me up to the DAZN matchroom office. I mean, I'll try and get this view in, but it is something special.
Well, we're very lucky, and yeah, there's two floors of this One World Trade Center. Mm-hmm. I'd like to say we have two of them, but we just have half a floor, which is still amazing.
Amazing. Definitely.
So, big thank you to DAZN, obviously, for accommodating us, and this is our US headquarters. Amazing place to work. Got our staff in here, we're up to about 10 or 11 now, full-time staff at the Matchroom HQ. So
bigger and bigger.
Yeah, and I mean, if you can't get motivated waking up and coming to work here, I don't know where you're going to get motivated.
Exactly. So, as soon as I walked in here, I had to take a picture. Yeah, it's very, very beautiful. I mean, you said it's a great place to work. There's ping pong machines there, there's food over there, there's a lovely kitchen there. I mean,
I think it's like new wave. Obviously, DAZN is, you know, new wave business, you know, streaming service, very cutting edge, high energy, and that's when you go to a lot of those places, like when you go to Google, when you go to YouTube's office, it's the same kind of vibe.
Yeah.
You know, it's that sort of energetic place to work. And I think any business should try and have that sort of feeling when you're going to work. I think motivation is key for any employee.
Yeah.
And when you wake up in the morning, you've got to be excited to go to work. And imagine how many people in the world are not excited to go to work. Probably 90% of people who work would rather be anywhere else in the world but in their job, right? So if you can motivate people in the workplace, and of course that comes from financial motivation, but that's got to come from just well-being, everything. And you know, it's everything from, you know, like in our UK HQ, we've got a gym, we've got a pool, you know, people go out in the afternoon for runs around the, you know, it's like a loop around the office. It's, I don't know, 3 miles.
Countryside, isn't it?
Yeah, it is, but it's like, you know, you've got to feel, you've got to enjoy what you do. And from a selfish point of view, from, you know, from director level, you want people to be happy, not just for their own well-being, but also a happy person, happy employee, will also you've got more chance for them delivering for you.
Exactly.
And they deserve respect as well. So I think what DAZN try and do is it's that same kind of feeling. You walk up there, you've got all your foods, your coffees, and whatever you want, like I say, pinball, table tennis over there,
TVs,
but you've got the greatest view.
I mean, that view alone, for me, has
to inspire you, because for me, coming in here, that inspires me. So when I'm sitting here in the office and I'm looking out there, I'm thinking, fuck, like, you know.
I'm glad you said it was this place. Like, I thought it was the Matchroom office.
When I said to you Matchroom office, you're in what, your Renaissance Hotel, you know, this is our office. It's humbling to think about, you know, I say where we came from. I mean, you know, I've been brought up, you know, luckily in this world, but the Hearn family, when you talk about coming out of, you know, council house in Dagenham, what my dad's achieved what I've helped achieve a little bit along the way is that, you know, we are a massive global business now, and obviously this is our American HQ, and we're very proud of that. So
I feel very lucky to be here, so thank you for this.
Thank you.
Let's get down to the nitty gritty, let's get down to business. The reason why we're in New York tonight, today, is obviously Devin Haney against Dilraoy Abdaliyev. There's also Heather Hardy, Serrano, and Michael Hunter as well against Guzman. But before we talk about them and break down the card, let's talk about the main event, Devin Haney. I mean, I had a good chat with him last night. For 20 years old, that's
probably it's amazing.
The coolest guy I've ever met. Yeah. Like, he's just so relaxed. He's like, give me Lomachenko, I don't care. Yeah. Give me this guy, I don't care. I mean, for 20 years old, he's got an old head on his shoulders, isn't he?
Yeah, and I'm hoping that he is what I believe he is, because if he is, he's going to be one of the biggest stars I think America's ever produced in the sport of boxing, because his work ethic, his personality, his mindset, you know, he's got everything. But he's 20. That's probably my biggest worry, is his age.
Yeah.
You know, and when I first heard about Devin Haney, I watched him on Showtime. I was like, oh, this guy's a star, you know. And I looked at it, I was like, Devin Haney Promotions. Oh no. Bill Haney. Oh no, like his father, son, they want their own promotional company, there'll be a nightmare. And then we got hooked up, and soon I realised that Bill Haney was very smart. Bill Haney has absolutely the best interests for his son. But they were never offered a deal in the early stages of their career that they felt justified Devin's ability and saleability. So when they got to a certain level, all built by Devin Haney Promotions, they had the smartness and sort of that lack of ego to say, okay, now we want to team up with a big organisation and a big promoter. Yeah. For DAZN, the fit with Devin Haney is so perfect, because we talked about all the things I said about, you know, DAZN as a business, DAZN as a content provider, that freshness, that new wave energy. Devin's got all of that, and he appeals to that younger generation, and they saw that as well with the link up with DAZN. So when I went to Las Vegas, I still had the perception of Devin Haney lives in Las Vegas. Oh my God, like what? This is so sad. Went to watch him work, went to watch him train, and I was like, wow. One, he looks unbelievable, but two, the setup's first class. You know, left there, went back to the apartment, he went to sleep, went back, I went to watch him train later, and it was like, it started reminding me of Floyd Mayweather. Mm. For all Mayweather's criticism, his work ethic is unbelievable. And you don't achieve what Floyd Mayweather has achieved without that work ethic. Yeah. You just don't. Because there's, you know, along the way, there's women, there's drugs, there's alcohol, there's money, there's violence, there's all these things that you're going to be exposed to growing up in Las Vegas, you know, being part of these, you know, groups of people that are going out and enjoying themselves. Like, it's so easy at 20.
Exactly,
like, how can you, and I sit here now as a 40-year-old, knowing that what it takes, but at 20, you don't care what it takes to be successful. You want, you know, I want, what, we're going out, we're doing this. And how do you have that mindset at 20? It's phenomenal.
Yeah.
And he won't let anything get in the way of his success. He'd never cut a training session. He'd never go out late and miss his sleep. He'd never eat the wrong stuff. He'd never go out and get drunk. No, he'd never get in trouble. And these are all the things you want from a superstar and a role model and a potential ambassador for the sport. So, but what we saw against Antonio Moran was a brilliant performance and a great knockout. Now you start going into serious stuff. You start going into deeper waters against our Abdullayev, who is unbeaten, who's got a very good team around him, who really believe, like they're saying to me yesterday, who'd this guy, you know, Haney walks in with 40 people. Is he really this good? You know, we don't think he's that good. I'm like, well, we're going to find out, aren't we? So you have a Russian who can punch, who's here to win, who's very strong. And that's what we want. We want someone to get on Haney's chest, push him back, find out what he's all about. Because the only thing we don't know about Devin Haney right now is, I don't know, I guess his toughness and his heart. You know, we've been told about that through sparring and through, but we want to see it in the ring. And if he's got that as well as all the other attributes, then at 20 years old, the world's his oyster. But in terms of excitement, I don't know, you know, I haven't seen this much hype around a young fighter. In America, I mean, when you look across the board, you know, you've got Devin Haney, Ryan Garcia, maybe Shakur Stevenson, Teofimo Lopez,
Javante Davis.
Yeah, but Davis is kind of like, he's got it now, do you know what I mean? I don't think you can call any of those guys certain prospects, but, you know, I think Javante is out of the prospect range now. You know, he's a star.
He's a star.
So it's very exciting to have what I believe is the number one of that group, and to have a piece of, hopefully, American boxing history moving forward. I think there you've got a guy who can become a 2-3-4-weight world champion. You know, but he must win that world title at lightweight. An interim world title is not a world title. That's cheating.
Yeah, so we
got to get that one for real. And I've said to Devin, if you win tonight, you need to call Lomachenko's name because you're mandatory for it. So they won't fight you. Bob's already said we will not fight Devin Haney.
But you've worked well with Bob of late.
Yeah, but Bob's gone a little bit psycho.
Oh, he's called you.
Yeah, I know. Well, I've seen that. I see his interview yesterday. It's like Umar's just such a clout chaser.
Umar's like
Clickbait City. You know, he's like, Bob, have you heard what Eddie Hearn said? And so, you know, Bob's like goes on these ego trips, and he's on one at the moment, and he won't want Devin to fight Lomachenko.
Yeah.
But the fact is, we're not calling Lomachenko randomly.
Mm.
We're his mandatory.
Exactly.
So what we're saying is, and by the way, he's got to win tonight first, but what we're saying is, if you're going to fight in between now, we understand you want to be undisputed,
mm-hmm.
and you should want to take that fight. Lopez, commie winner. That's in December. Comey, by the way, as far as I'm concerned, has said he won't fight Lomachenko if he beats Lopez because he wants to keep defending the title. So we'll see what happens then. But that fight's not going to happen until April, May. So what is he going to have? Nearly a year out of the ring before he fights for the undisputed. So what I'm saying is, if Lomachenko fights between the undisputed fight and now, you must fight Haney because there's your mandatory. And the fans, if Devin looks great tonight, then the fans will call that fight on. And that's what I want them to do, is say no. Because Loma's a legend, right? Loma's not scared of anyone. Like, do you think Loma will look at Haney and go, oh, I'm not going to fight Haney? Or anybody, Gervonta Davis. So it won't be Loma, it'll be Bob. So we've got to put the pressure on to try and make that fight. And if Lomachenko's going to have a year out of the ring, let Devin fight for the world title, because he can't wait at 135. Yeah. He made the weight well this time, but it's a struggle.
I seen him, so, you know, when a fight is tight in the way, he invited me for dinner last night, and I said, that was a video start, and I thought, I'll just leave you in peace just now, and I'll get you when you come back with a full belly. So
he was okay, he's still tight all the time. Yesterday was better than the last fight. Last fight was a real struggle, and we did have conversations about moving to 140 now, but this camp, thank God, you know, everything on point, and made the weight well and ready to go. But he will, I think he only has one or two fights left after this at 35.
And you won that world title.
He has to, because if he's going to be a multi-weight world champion, which I really believe he will, you've got to get the lightweight one. Because he can win a title at 140. I think he'll end up at 147. He's even talking about 54. He's quite a tall guy. When you look at Abdullayev, all throughout the like all the pictures in training and footage, I thought Abdullayev's tall. And then you look at Haney's taller, you know?
I took a picture of him yesterday. He's actually taller than
me. Yeah. Well, that's not hard. You're about 5'3".
Oh, 5'4", come on, Eddie.
Yeah, so he's bigger than he looked, and he's 20. Yeah. You don't stop growing until you're 21, 22. So, I just, what I'm excited about Devin is, if he is what I believe he is, he's going to be massive, massive. And, yeah, he was a big catch for us, and we're excited, and we think we're going to do a great job for him.
Okay, well, let's see if you can get the Lomachenko fight next for Haney. Would you bring him over to the UK? I mean, you've done that with a lot of your US fighters.
To be honest with you, Andrew, it's just cost.
Yeah.
Like, and this is being totally blunt with fans, is obviously American broadcasters pay a lot of money for people like Devin Haney. We can't afford to put those guys on a UK Saturday night fight night, unless it's a pay-per-view. And Devin Haney, you know, the only pay-per-view that might be out there is if Devin Haney went and won the WBC full world title and Luke Campbell fought someone else and all of a sudden that became a fight, is that a pay-per-view? Maybe. But it's really hard to bring the American stars to the UK unless it's fighting a UK star on pay-per-view. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's like Usyk. I thought about, you know, with Usyk, he's fighting in Chicago. Tickets have gone really well, actually. We've sold over 5,000 already, but I could probably fill the O2 with Usyk against Takam, against Spung. You know, all these guys. Yeah, he is. So, and Lomachenko the same. You know, so we want to bring these guys. I mean, I saw your interview yesterday with Raymond Ford and people like that, and that's. Like the real benefit is the younger kids.
Younger kid that I...
Stephen
Acosta, he's been on me all week.
Yeah.
He says, I want to sign with Eddie, man.
I know, so like it.
I'll speak to him, so he's thinking the best
nice.
Moment in the
that's,
world.
That's
so.
Nice, because yeah, you want the younger generation to want to sign with Matrim, or, you know, because... And you want that kind of image that the younger fighters... Word of mouth's massive in boxing. And I don't believe there's many fighters, if any fighters, that would speak badly about Matrim and me. They might think I'm a prick, but they wouldn't say, oh...
I'm probably the only one in boxing that doesn't think
you're
a prick.
Or he didn't pay me on time, or he lied about dates, or he shortchanged me, or they treated me badly, or, you know, the team are rubbed. Like, you don't get that with us. So, and that's important to us, because word of mouth in any business is huge. And within the circle of young fighters, you're only really as good as your reputation. So when that kid says, no, I want to be a Matrim, you know, I spoke to Ray Ford and he really looks after them, you know, he took them to the UK to fight, his boxing at Madison Square Garden. That's priceless. Yeah. that reputation. So I haven't heard of that kid, but I looked into.
It was meant to fight in Dallas, but his opponent pulled out. So it was meant to be in Dallas, but yeah. All week he's been on at me.
Yeah, no, it's nice. It's hard because everybody, like, we get. I'll tell you another funny story. So, someone, I don't know if you saw my Instagram story where I said, if you get an email.
Yeah, I've seen that.
So, someone has set up an email account saying eddie.hearn or something like that at outlook.com, right? And has emailed and, like, everybody, right? From MMA fighters to boxers. Like anyone involved, we've got commentators, like anyone. I had
stateside or UK?
Both. Right. I had even the agency that provide the ring card girls. some of them, right, saying hi, Eddie Hearn here. I'm in. Some said New York. Well, some said London. Right. Yeah. And I would like to have a meeting with you to talk about DAZN and some really exciting opportunities. I've been getting reply like. On my Instagram, MMA fighters that I've never even heard of going, hi, I got your email, just want to check that it's actually you about the meeting. And I'm like, I'm really sorry, but no, it's not me. So if you get an email from Eddie Hearn at outlook.com,
I'm going to check my email.
Yeah, it's not from me. It's not from me. But the sadness of someone has set up this account and spent days finding out other people's email addresses. And I've got another one as well. Apparently in Thailand, someone was pretending to be me by asking people for money, and someone messaged me and said, oh, you know, I got your story, and it really touched my heart, so, you know, I sent the money. I'm like,
why would you be asking for money?
They sent me this thing, and it was speaking to them in Thai. Do you know what I mean? So it's like, just to let you know, I can't speak Thai, I don't work off translator. So, yeah.
Oh, seriously?
I don't know, it's obviously.
It seems like everybody wants to be Eddie Hearn then.
Well, I don't know, everyone wants to try and stitch me up. So, yeah, I don't know where we're going with that. So, no, I talk about reputation. So, yeah. That's good. You know, like I said, we've got to try and make sure that our reputation in boxing is good. We're going to get our criticism, but as long as the criticism comes from.
Success,
no, as long as the criticism comes from the jealous people or the people with an agenda, rather than the true people you're actually dealing with. That's okay. Yeah. You've got to expect to be criticised by Aaron, Warren, you know, all those kind of people. You've even got a coffee service.
Coffee service, yeah. Frank's.
But with the fighters, that's the key. Because everybody, since we come into the US market, everyone's done everything they can to try and slow our progress down. But I always say to fighters, speak to, you know, our fighters.
Yeah.
See what they say.
Let's go down the card. I'm going to talk about Haney reputation. Mm. I want to talk about Heather Hardy and Amanda Serrano. I mean, this fight is probably the fight I'm looking forward to the most. Yeah. Because it's just the Brooklyn girl, all that sort of dynamic behind it.
Sold a lot of tickets, you know, and in terms of women's boxing, mm-hmm. probably one of the top five fights out there in women's boxing right now. I mean, Taylor against the winner is an even bigger fight.
Is that meant to be June 6 months or something like that?
Well, they're both signed to fight Katie Taylor after. So Katie's going to fight in November. And then after that, I believe she'll. I mean, we've got to fit the Pearsoon rematch in as well. That's very important that fight happens. Then she's got Serrano. She's got all these fights to make. So this fight, for me, great fight. I think Serrano's the favourite in the fight. I think she punches very hard. Heather Hardy's tough. Mm. Tough. I mean, you watch her in that Bellator. She's on the floor. She's getting, like, kicked in the head. And she won't tap out. Mm. Do you know what I mean? And, like, the refs look at her. I mean, she's real tough. I think Amanda might be a little bit too much for her, but she won't quit. And this is like, I watched her podcast interview with Frampton and on Joe on their podcast, and Chris Lloyd. And I feel like with women's boxing, it's funny how things progress. Like 12 months ago, women just wanted a spot. Yeah. Like on the card. Now they want to be main event. Yeah. Now they want the same money as the men. Do you know what I mean? And I don't blame them for that. But it's mad how it's moved so quickly.
Yeah.
Whereby if you put a female fight on your card 12 months ago, or maybe a little bit before, that was revolutionary. Now, I'm getting a bit of stick. Like before Roman Akhmadaliyev fell off the card, I wasn't sure what would be co-main event. You know, it's like people emailing me, like abusing me, saying, you're a disgrace, how can this be? And both girls are making a lot of money tonight. You know, I was looking at in that article where Heather was saying, yeah, I made $6,000 or something to defend my WBC title. Well, she's making 20 times that tonight, or something like that, you know, I don't know. So it's great that they're getting the opportunity. And the fact is, and the truth is, when you talk about equality, financial equality in sport, you have to look at, just because one's male and one's female, doesn't automatically give you an edge in what you should earn. Everything should be a balance in terms of commercial revenue and commercial saleability. If Heather Hardy and Serrano are selling more tickets, have more interest from the broadcaster than another fight, and that fight is making more money, they're getting paid more money. Why? Well, because one's female, one's male, and that's wrong. So it's just a changing world, and we'll get there.
Do you think there'll be equality, or just fairness? The same what Ludabella said, that he seems to think there won't be equality, but at least
I think we need to get this. I mean, it's going to be difficult, you know, and I think the one that's going to get to equality the fastest is Katie Taylor. You know, I think she's going to, and she's not far off now, you know, those kind of levels where she is making the same money as championship men, and, you know, high level, big name championship men as well. And why not?
Yeah.
She's achieved more than them, you know. More people might want to watch her fight than them fight.
You've got a huge fan base now,
isn't it? So that's, you know, that's what we're up against. And every time I do a new contract with Katie, after a year, those numbers don't look as good as they did a year before. So then I give her more money and we do a new one. Do you know what I mean? Because when we first signed her, it's a bit like AJ. Now, we talk all the time about his money when he first turned pro. And we laugh about it now because it looks shit. Like, because of how boxing's changed.
Yeah.
And the same with Katie. You know, when we first started out, she was on like, I don't know, 10,000 a fight or something like that. And we look at it now, she's like, you were robbing me. It's like, no, that's just what it was then. Yeah. But now, and then we do another contract, and then 6 months later, that don't look very good. So we change it. And, you know, she's...
As long as it keeps on going up and up and up.
Yeah, we'll always get it. That's what we want. I saw Bob Arum in his interview, said, all Eddie Hearn does is write his fighters big checks. Okay, if that's the criticism you got, I'll take that reputation. But that's what it's all about. I want to try and pay my fighters as much money as possible. Because generally it means you'll make more money and you'll have the bigger fights. Just like my dad says about tax. You know, I always say to him, fucking taxes. Ed, I love paying tax. I say, why? He says, I want to pay as much tax as possible. I said, why? He says, because then I know I'm making loads of money. So that's the mindset.
That's your dad.
No, but that's because he's always half glass full with
me.
I say, look at the tax bill. Great, you made loads of money. It's like, yeah, but look at the tax bill. Yeah, but you made loads of money. You know, so.
So I'm gonna think like that.
That's what you want. Yeah, it's a good mentality. So I say to him, you've got to want to pay as much tax as possible.
That'll be the headline for this.
Yeah. I'm sure you'll find something.
Oh, definitely. Hunter versus Kuzmin.
Brilliant fight.
Hunter's in the heavyweight division. He called himself, when I interviewed him, the Giant Slayer.
Yeah.
I mean, he wins this fight. How far is he off from maybe facing...
I mean, look, he nearly got the Joshua fight. Mm-hmm. You know, over Ruiz. Maybe we should have given him that fight instead. So, for me, these are the kind of fights that I love about boxing. Right, where you've got two guys who, Hunter and Kuzmin, who are sitting there, really in position to get a fight with Fury, Wilder, Wyatt, Ortiz, you know, Usyk maybe. So, and they're all seven-figure paydays, right? Some of them, maybe not the Usyk fight. And then, no, we'll fight each other for much, much less money. But I know that if we win that fight, we'll move up the rankings and we'll get even more for a big fight. Because we believe we can beat this guy.
Yeah.
And working with World of Boxing and Vadim Kornilov, who's got Akhmadaliyev, who's got Madrimov, who's got Giasov, they'll fight anyone. Do you know what I mean? It's so refreshing. You haven't got to ask them twice. And I spoke to Vadim and Rybinski, and I said, look, Kuzmin Hunter. Yes, no problem. I spoke to Hunter, will fight anyone. I mean, he fought Bacoli when no one wanted to fight Bacoli.
Yeah.
And he beat Bacoli. Then he boxed Ustinov.
Yeah.
Beat him. Then he boxed recently in Maryland against, I can't remember his name, easy-ish fight. Proper tough fight tonight.
He's knocked them all out, is so far.
Yeah, tough fight tonight. Big guy, great amateur experience. I think Hunter's speed is going to be key in this fight. But I also think he looks in great shape, Hunter. Look at Hunter on the scales yesterday compared to Hunter on the scales against Ustinov.
Yeah.
Right? Different physique. He's growing into heavyweight. Never going to be a massive heavyweight. What did he weigh? 222 pounds. Kuzmin weighs the same as me, because I looked at the scales, it was like 17, 12 or something. No, fuck that. No. It'd kill me. Just really excited about that fight, because it's a complete heavyweight 50-50. Two guys, lot of skill, power. I think it's going to be a brilliant fight.
Talking about heavyweights, I'm going to try and pronounce his name. Your new signing.
Yeah.
Mago
Medrasil Majidov.
Fair play to you, Eddie. I'm trying to practice that all night. But talk to me about him. He doesn't look the biggest heavyweight,
no,
but he's a so, world amateur champion.
Yeah, so we're doing some stuff in Azerbaijan. Mm-hmm. We're going to be doing a show there next year. And the commission came to me and said, we'd like you to do a show in Azerbaijan, which is exciting. And would you be interested in signing Majidov? So I knew all about Majidov, watched him for years in the amateurs, beat AJ in the World Championship finals just before the Olympics. Close fight, very close fight. And always had a reputation of being a bit of a beast, but he's 32. And spoke to the team and they said, look, basically, give him an 8-rounder. Tonight only got sanctioned for a 6 because it's his debut. And then 10, and then a 10, and put him in with Kuzmin, Hunter, you know, all these guys. So when you know there's a heavyweight willing to move at that kind of pace, it's quite exciting, because you don't have to build them. You know, you don't have to turn around and say, oh, we've got to give him 8 fights in year one. And not. So we're going to find out very quickly. The amateur pedigree's there, the ability's there. I spoke to Josh about him. He went, fuck me, he's a fucking animal,
really?
That guy. So got a good fight tonight. Got quite an experienced southpaw. So we'll find out. Excited about him. I mean, again, one that you can box tonight. He'll box again in probably Monaco, November 30th, and then let him go. Stick him in a title fight, 3 or 4 fights. So, you know, not a lot of investment from us in terms of time mainly, but also money, to find out if we've got a very good heavyweight. Because, I like him. He's got a nice fight about him.
I want to stay on heavyweights then. Mm. Nice and Fury 1. Just give me your thoughts on that, please.
I've said a few things this week. You can't expect people to give you criticism and to just not say anything back.
Yeah.
You know, so like Aaron, for example, you know, comes over last week in Lomachenko, you know, his head's up my bum. You know what I mean? Oh, this is amazing. And then on the sly, wants to slate you. Oh, DAZN has been a disaster. DAZN hasn't been. DAZN's been going for October 10 months. Been revolutionary for the sport of boxing in America. So for him to criticise it like he's criticising it, he's out of one thing, fear for what's happening. And when he says things about all Eddie Hearn wants to do is give fighters big checks, what that tells you is he's run out of money, because he's now telling all his fighters, we haven't got a date for you this year, so you're going to have to wait till next year. Well, we've seen that over history of time with PBC, really. So, you know, if you're running out of money, artillery, you start getting aggressive publicly, and this and that's a joke, he's paying him too much. Don't worry about what we're paying, worry about your own business.
Yeah.
But if you criticise fights for not delivering, you can't then not expect me to talk about Fury against Otto Warling, which is, like I said in the interview, been a disaster.
Mm-hmm.
You know, sold a couple of thousand tickets, and you'll see it, because Las Vegas publish those results. And how many subs is that going to, you know, with the money that's costing that fight? I mean, God knows what Fury's making, 10 million plus, whatever, plus Wilding.
Yeah.
The show's going to cost 15 million plus. So they're going to take about 150,000 on the gate. So Who's paying for the rest? ESPN? If so, ESPN need to look at that and say, what is going on? But look at all the fights Aram's done. What big fight has Bob Arum put on in recent years? It's not, you know, that's like, and yes, I promoted that fight, but tell me a big fight that Bob Arum has promoted in recent years.
I said, tell you off camera.
Yeah, but, no, but you don't know because it's not on the top yet, but you can look into it. But, and tell me a fight that Bob Arum has done recently that has sold more than, I don't know, 5,000-6,000 tickets.
He wants to come into the UK.
He wants to say that because he wants to try and get on my tits and he's got a bit. But you can come in the UK, it's not that easy. Mm-hmm. And by the way, it's not that easy to come into the US. And we've found that out in many areas.
Yep.
You don't just bowl it. Look at Al Heyman. You know, comes in, big new deal with ITV. Oh, by the way, Spence Porter's on Sky.
Yeah.
Okay. Right, so that ain't worked, has it? And I think he's looked at it and thought, probably done Eubank Degal, did his Conkers. And then thought, do you know what, I'll stay in the US.
Yeah.
Coming here for us hasn't been easy. We've made mistakes, you know, we've learnt a lot, but we're not going anywhere. We're not going to dip in, dip out. So for Top Rank to look at the UK and say, well, there's an opportunity to make a few quid, doesn't necessarily work like that. Mm-hmm. If they do come, great. But, you know, I look at the Top Rank fights, I don't see any big subscription drivers. And I see what UFC are doing for ESPN and compare that to what Top Rank are delivering for ESPN, it's miles apart. Might not be a criticism of Top Rank, might just be a criticism of boxing in the US.
Yeah.
But, you know, I don't see Top Rank making any mega fights anymore. So, you know.
Is that due to the fighters they've got in their stable or?
Well, they've only really got two major names in their stable. If you put Fury in there, I guess three as well. So that's Crawford, Lomachenko and Fury. But Crawford and Lomachenko, who are, by the way, pound for pound greats, are they massive subscription drivers? Mm-hmm. Do they put a lot of bums on seats? Not really. So, I don't know. You know, again, it's not a criticism of Top Rank. It might just be a criticism of boxing in America, where you've got two pound for pound greats. You know, when Crawford boxed Khan, how many did they sell? Mm-hmm. 5,000? I don't know, 6,000? Like, so, what's the super fights or mega fights that Top Rank have done in the last 12, 18 months?
Mm.
You know, I see him putting on for like Pulev against Deenan was an ESPN fight. What's all that? You know, so, but Bob Arum is a legend. He's 87 years old. He's hilarious.
I think the fans like you and Bob Arum back and forth.
I have a huge amount of respect for Bob Arum, but he does talk bollocks and he's a little bit two-faced, so you know, but you have to respect what he's achieved.
You gotta go for that meeting,
surely. Yeah. And you have to respect his longevity. That's what I respect most about him, because I will not be here at 87 years old. I might not be
here
in this university. I doubt I will be, but I definitely will not be in boxing at 87 years old. I promise you that. I doubt I'll be here at 57. I might not be here at 47.
And you will be. You will be.
Yeah.
I know you've got a couple of questions. I'm going to just jump onto AJ and Ruiz in Saudi Arabia. Any news on anyone on the undercard?
Just had a meeting about that today. I want to do a couple of heavyweight fights. Another fight I really like, I've been looking at the moment, a bit of a random one. Scott Quigg against John O'Carroll. Just one that's come
that,
to
that,
me. Yeah,
that hasn't
yeah.
popped into anyone's head.
No. And
for Saudi?
Yeah. Well, no, just in general, in terms of the dates and how everything's dropping, that would fit perfectly in that date. I think the first undercard fights will be announced in about 2 weeks' time for Saudi.
Watch it then. Is there going to be any female? I think I read possibly. Some, like, two female fights on the card.
No, not definitely not two, no. Possibly one. But again, that's, you know, I think Saudi are trying to use these events to showcase change for them. So putting a female fight on would be historic in that respect,
yeah.
But might be a one step at a time scenario, but again, that's a decision for them.
KSI Logan Paul.
Yeah, press conference tomorrow.
Tomorrow.
I'm shitting myself.
Are you, honestly? Conference.
Because I watched the first one last night. It's absolute nuts. I mean, they're saying to me, just go on there and say a few words and then let them loose, right?
Just say a few words already.
It's probably going to be a little bit cringe. Now, I've had Logan Paul, not what am I talking about? Sorry. I've had Jake Paul. On. He's done a YouTube video calling for his fans to be on the card, right? Which has done like fucking millions of views and all this. And now I'm getting DMs on my Instagram saying, hey, you bum, put Jake Paul on. So And actually, he's not bad either. Yeah, I might have to put. Because I've come on, I've said. Because all my boxing related videos are now seen by the YouTube world.
Yeah.
Where I'm saying, no, I'm not putting YouTubers on the card. And then the YouTube world is saying to me,
that's my world.
You're disrespecting YouTube. Yeah. No, but I'm talking about the YouTube. YouTube. So there's, why are you not putting more YouTubers on the card? So you can't win either way. So I might have to look at putting. Jake Paul, Wilson.
And saying that, did you see Michelle Joy Phelps and Ben Davis's?
Yeah, but that's, I mean.
Because I want to put my, I would love to do it. If you want to, I would love to.
I'll tell you what I'm thinking about doing. Because this has had a lot of traction with people.
Me against Coogan.
I'm not going to call out who, but I've had a lot of celebrities and sports stars come on to me over the last week or so saying, could you do something like this with me? You know, like, it's not really about the money, I just love to do it.
Yeah, charity takes things.
Yeah, so I'm speaking to Sport Relief at the moment. About putting together some kind of that might not be high profile enough, Andrew.
I'll make it high profile. I'm going to take a shot.
What about Coogan against?
I'm going for that number one.
Coogan against Radio Raheem.
I think that's what everyone.
But I think in a Sport Relief environment, that would be a great thing to do, where we could actually put something together. And I'm talking to them at the moment, so tomorrow's going to be wild. I mean, we've sold, like, I don't know what the pre-sale tickets, 5,000 tickets on a pre-sale. Like, you struggle over here to do 500 tickets on a pre-sale, so. You know,
I'm surprised Coogan hasn't gone over for something like
that. I was at a wedding today.
Oh, he's at a wedding today, so yes, yeah.
So, tomorrow might be one of those press conferences where I'm just going,
I think you'll enjoy it, Eddie, to be honest.
But the buzz has been unbelievable. Yeah. Like, the numbers, you know, obviously we have all this digital analysis about stuff, and the numbers that come in on the announcement, on the, you know, like, these guys put out videos, do like 5, 6, 10 million views, just talking about.
See the first fight, sorry to interrupt you, Eddie. See the first fight in Manchester, Radio Raheem and Sekhs Out were the only boxing sort of YouTube channel that were there.
Mm.
And their hits from their interviews was like 2.2 million, 1.8 million. It was just. So, I mean, Coogan phoned me at that time saying, that's ridiculous numbers again. But they were we didn't go, IFL went there.
But you see what IFL will do that week with those, I mean, it'd be huge. And it's great, listen, I'm selfishly. Mm. Matchroom's YouTube channel, which
you
we launched.
You still get stick for it?
I get stick, mate. I get stick every day. You know, wake up in the morning, just look, go through my things. It's like non-stop stick. But they're starting to, like I say, but I'm starting to get worried if I don't get the stick. Mm. Do you know what I mean? Because I'm not doing something right. So, with the YouTube stuff, like selfishly, you go back to like the Matchroom YouTube channel, which was launched, I don't know, 6 months ago. Mm. Brilliant content, by the way. If you haven't subscribed to Matchroom YouTube channel, I'm disappointed. We're up to like, I don't know, 75,000 or something like that. And but it's content, it's not interviews. It's, And I want to grow that to 100, 150, 200. And this is a great opportunity for me to do that. So we just got to make, like, one of the YouTube sort of arguments was you need a Jake Paul or someone like that because you've got to bring the YouTubers to let them see the boxing.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? So, because I'm trying to say, no, I'm going to bring the YouTubers, but I'm going to bring the boxing so that they all watch that. But it's getting the balance right.
Yeah.
So, we'll have to see.
I know Billy Joe's on it.
Billy Joe, will announce that officially on Saturday tomorrow.
Oh, you got his opponent?
No, we'll do that next week, but I just want to get in mindset with Billy to say, that's your day, it's all locked in. Yeah.
Billy's going to be our fun.
Yeah, I spoke to him about it. He understands. You know, he's not an idiot. He understands the benefit of it. We need to raise his profile in America. And this is a great, you know, if I did Billy Joe on his own in America, might do 4,000 or 5,000, might do a couple of 100,000 on DAZN.
Mm.
If I did him here, it's in front of 20,000, you know, it could be 1 million on DAZN, plus worldwide, huge, so.
His name will be out there. Yeah, it will be. Like I said, you're a busy man.
All right, mate, we'll catch up tonight.
Definitely.
Yeah.
I'm looking forward to the fight. Thanks so much, Eddie. Thank you.
Cheers.
Once the opportunity arose for him to close the show, he did it in emphatic style.
Whatever he hits falls.